This is The Future Of, where experts share their vision of the future and how their work is helping shape it for the better. I'm Sarah Tallier. The UN's 12th Sustainable Development Goal, Sustainable Consumption and Production, discusses the need for a circular economy and how waste, especially hazardous waste, is minimised. Here in Western Australia, the government is supporting research initiatives designed to do just that. In this episode, I spoke with Associate Professor Elsayed Oraby from the Curtin WA School of Mines, Minerals, Energy and Chemical Engineering. Dr Oraby is leading an innovative research project to recover precious and base metals and remove toxic metals from e-waste. If you'd like to find out more about Dr Oraby's research, you can visit the links provided in the show notes. Dr Oraby, first, can you explain exactly what e-waste is?
Yes, sure. E-waste stands for electronic and electric waste. When different sources of electronic and electric material reach end of the life, they are considered as e-waste. For example, e-waste, it's really present in our everyday life, such as phones, TVs, computers, and home appliances.
Is e-waste actually increasing along with the increase of smart appliances like fridges?
Yes, I think so. The smart appliances like fridges, televisions, microwave, ovens, projectors, and extras, you know, are popular in our homes and workplaces. With the technology advancement and the smart appliances lifespan is becoming shorter than before, and their penetration rate will remain high in the community. This will lead to high rate of increasing of electronic waste. Also, more people now is buying smartphone, electronic appliance, smartphones with a shorter life and fewer option for repair.
So I mean, that goes feeds into the next question really quite naturally, Sayed. Why is it important to actually recycle e-waste, especially consider at the rate of its increase?
That's really a very good question, Sarah. There are two major problems or reasons why we need to consider the e-waste to be recycled back again. There is an environmental and economic reason to that. E-waste contains high level of toxic and heavy metals such as mercury, lead, cadmium, and chromium, and also toxic organic substances. So the e-waste recycling is very important. Most of the e-waste comes from metal that present in the electronic wires and printed circuit boards. Different types of e-waste contain different valuable precious metals. So the level of gold and silver will be different from TV to fridges and other appliances. Printed circuit board from TV only contain about 10 to 20 gram per ton gold and about 100 to 100 gram per ton silver. However, from computer, the printed circuit board is about 100 to 500 gram per ton of gold, and for silver is much higher than that. So the precious metal content in the electronic component of computer is very high, especially with another component like the RAMs, like memory, it contains even sometimes 1,000 gram per ton of gold. No, there is a big value, economic value of the e-waste.
Tell us about your project that has received funding from the Western Australian government.
Yeah, that project really helped us a lot to achieve the result we achieved. We got a grant from a waste sorted grant from Western Australian government to study and develop a new process to recover precious and base metal from electronic waste. So we developed environmental benign, non-toxic process to recover base metal, which is including copper mainly on the printed circuit board. And then we recover after that the precious metal out of electronic waste. So grant was about $200,000 from the government. And we work from a postdoctor, Dr. Juan Lee, work in the project with the help of the group leader, Professor Jack Steen, on that project.
Can you give us a sense of what the process of extracting precious metals is actually like with these devices, with this technology?
Yeah, it's a very simple process. We're just utilizing an environmental benign reagent. It's called amino acids. It's non-toxic. So we utilize this instead of using acid, which is a very corrosive, or using cyanide, which is very toxic. So having a non-toxic reagent like amino acids is really much better to solve the current problem of using toxic reagent in the urban areas.
So it's obviously a far more environmentally friendly process, leaching process that you have helped to develop. But what about, how does it compare to the cost of the traditional leaching method?
Yeah, it's really quite a bit cheaper because it's not decomposed or consumed during the leaching. So we recycle most of it back again and we recover the base metal and precious metal easily out of the solution. So it's a quite really good interest from different industry, not only in the e-waste, in different industries as well, in gold and copper and currently in nickel and cobalt.
How much future capacity do you think that leaching process has? How much potential do you think it has with leaching these types of precious metals and other metals?
It's quite interesting. They think for every circuit board, its value is about $10,000 per ton of the printed circuit board. That's a very valuable and really work close to have a mobile plant, which you can move it from area to area. You don't need to move the e-waste to the plant. We can make a portable plant, can be moved from area to area.
So if you're looking at one of these circuit boards, what actually happens to it for it to be extracted? If you can describe what actually happens physically with it.
You get the printed circuit board, you take the battery out, and then board will be shredded on a special crushers, and then after that you grind it to a certain size. And then you add this powder or a coarse powder of printed circuit board in our chemical reagent, and then it will leach in about 24 to 48 hours. You extract your metal out in the solution. And then after that, the residue will be just only the mix of plastic and the other non-metal component and the e-waste.
What types of uses do some of these metals end up having?
The metal, as you know, precious gold. Everyone knows gold is going for lots of uses and then can be recycled back again and reuse that metal on the industry again.
Do people need to be more mindful of recycling e-waste, Elsayed?
I think yes. Yeah. Sometimes, the e-waste is dumping occasionally to our environment or on the verge of the roads. This could pose really risk to our environment. This is really the other side of the e-waste problem. Because as I mentioned, e-waste contains mercury, lead, cadmium, and all other toxic environments. So with our reliable system of waste management, toxic substance can be released to the environment and can destroy the environment and the ecosystem. So this is one mindful about the environmental as well effect and as well the economic, as I mentioned. There is a value of this e-waste. Don't throw it away. Just look to the right place to recycle it back again. And might be in the future you can get some small benefit back of recycling this type of material.
Thanks, Syed. We're now going to take just a short break and we'll be back just after this ad.
Are you interested in a research degree? At Curtin University, we'll help you build knowledge in your profession and turn your discoveries into real-world outcomes. You'll benefit from resources and support across areas like agriculture and environment, defence, and healthy communities. Our commitment to innovative research has seen 95% of our projects rated at or above world standard in the latest ERA results. Learn how your research could make an impact at curtin.edu/research.
Before the ad, Elsayed, you talked about the need for people to be more conscious of recycling e-waste. What are some of the basic things that we can do to help address the problem of e-waste?
Thanks, Sarah. Once again, it's a really good question. And so I think there are several ways we can help solve the problem of e-waste. Be mindful of replacing their electronic and electronic waste devices and equipment. Do we really need to update our mobile phones or computers in 1 or 2 years' time? You can see lots of big company and big institution. They just, update the computers and electronics for just 2 years. The question is, can we extend that? The second really is a reuse. So the second-hand use of this recycling before we just say and recycling. The third point, once the e-waste and the electronic equipment and mobile phones and computer reach the end life, how we can just dispose it? They just not put it on the verge or whatever. It's better to bring them to the right place, bring them to the professional e-waste treatment company, collect them there, or just, drop them to the nearest council area. And it really is another rule of the council there to put like a special pins to collect the e-waste sorted. You can see the example the government for about the plastic bottles recycling. It's 10 cent bay for each bottle. If we bought something like that, bring your old mobile phone or old televisions, and there is some a little tiny reward of that. That might be help people to just take their electronic waste and put it in the right place. And this will help solve the problem. Slightly different than the answer of the question, but why will landfill material containing this amount of money, as I mentioned, it's up to $10,000 per ton? And as well, it contains lots of toxic metals to the environment, such as mercury, cadmium, and lead.
Is there any way that reclaiming precious metals through this method could ever replace mining?
Oh, that's it. it's exciting. Yeah, I think, Sarah, that's the question came up because the value. Unfortunately, even the e-waste is really high value of a precious metal content. And just to give you an example of the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, says 1 metric ton of circuit board contains about 40 to 800 times the amount of gold and about 30 to 40 times the amount of copper mined from one metric ton of ore in the United States. But the volume of e-waste compared with the volume and the masses of the mine, gold mines or ore, the resources, very little. We need to stop landfill the electronic waste. We need to recycle it. We need to recover back, you know, clean it up from the toxic elements. We need to recover the precious metal and base metal out of it and then leave it clean and nice to the landfill or going for another purposes.
So stop it before it even ends up in the landfill is the goal now. But I can imagine you driving past a landfill site and seeing something very different from what most motorists see. You see a lot of opportunity there.
There is a lot of opportunity of treating e-waste. And really, I think, as you can see, lots of research and lots of company working on that area because the value is very clear, as I mentioned there. It's very valuable to recover and environmentally, which is more important. To make sure, you know, that all the toxic elements not generate to the environment and destroy the ecosystem.
What do you think, given all of this potential, is the future of e-waste management?
I'm really very positive on this, based on lots of researchers, lots of people that want to invest money on it, and as well lots of government. It's become like, officially required to make sure, you know, control the e-waste. So I feel the future will be much better. We have, as I mentioned, mobile plant to move from state to state or from city to city to process the e-waste and, you know, recycle the valuable metal out of it.
You're a metallurgical engineer. What brought you to working in the area of e-waste? How did that happen?
Yeah, as I mentioned, electronic waste is one of the emerging problems worldwide. For me as a researcher working at university, we know e-waste is a problem. So the one role of the researcher is solving problem in a scientific manner. So e-waste is a problem, and it contains lots of metals. And this is what means of metallurgical engineer here, just to try to extract that metals out and solve the current problem of e-waste. So this is one of role of any research. So we think about what's the current process they're using. Okay, lots of people, they're using toxic or corrosive reagent, and then we try to utilize things outside this, non-toxic and non-corrosive material there to recover the metal out from this one and solve the problem. This is the main reason here. As a researcher, try to solve the problem which is facing the community of increasing the increasing number of e-waste. This has really brought me to do some research on the e-waste with the team, definitely.
Of course, with a team. And how long has it taken you and the team from concept to now coming up with this new, more environmentally friendly leaching process?
Yeah, that's leaching process. Really, it's wide applications. So we invented to work for many applications, not only for e-waste. So in the application of e-waste, I started 2015, 2016. So it's about almost 7 years working on the e-waste. And then once we get the grant, we get a boss doctor, as I mentioned, Dr. Juan Lee. He did fantastic job in this. We published about 5 good journals as well in very prestigious journal covering the different aspects of e-waste and how we can recover the precious and base metal in different steps. The plan is in the process, we will get the base metal, which mainly copper and lead and zinc, and then we'll go for second step, we get the precious metals, which gold and palladium and silver, and then we end up with the waste with just containing the plastic and the non-metal component, which it can be repurposed. You can use it for another applications, or it can be safe to go to the landfill.
Now, I wonder, from if we rewind to when you were starting out your career as an academic, is there anything that you wish you knew about this topic before you got started?
Not specific in the US, but for my philosophy as a researcher, when I started, I'm just looking to problems, to solving a problem. So that's really my career. Looking to any problem for mining, precious metal mining or base metal mining as well, this is my duty. My PhD was doing as well non-toxic reagent like using thiosulfate for leaching gold. So it wasn't planned, but really with the time, okay, it's e-waste is a major problem. Then we try to find a solution for this problem. And this is the philosophy from now on as well, not in e-waste. We're not stopping that. We'll keep looking for what's the problems in industry, how we can solve it as a scientist and Curtin University as well to solve the problem facing the mining and the engineering field.
Dr. Elsayed Oraby, thank you so much for chatting with us today. I really look forward to seeing what's ahead next for you and for coming in and sharing your knowledge about harvesting from e-waste and how we can all do our bit to help.
Thanks, Sarah, a lot. Much appreciated. Thanks for having me for this nice conversation.
You've been listening to The Future Of, a podcast powered by Curtin University. As always, if you've enjoyed this episode, please share it. And don't forget to subscribe to The Future Of on your favourite podcast app. Bye for now.